Let's talk about something which is very popular instead, which is the sound frontal approach, which is compared to that one, is fairly simple. This approach, as you can see in this, we've seen before. Before we used to do a little bit more the bifrontal. Now I do mostly the unifrontal as much as I can. The advantage of doing unifrontal, subfrontal, unilateral, but subfrontal approach, because I don't invade the frontal sinus, which I don't have to do any reconstruction, or any cranialization, or any sealing in the frontal sinus. So I keep myself lateral to it as much as I can. And the other variation of this approach, which I'm going to see a little bit later, will be the supraorbital, which is made basically the same surgical trajectory, but just a little bit less bone resection. Basically, you know, most of the times you don't need that much bone resection because in the end of the day, you try not to retract the frontal lobe too much. But in some cases you have to because the resection, I mean, the tumor is particularly large. This approach is basically, could be particularly useful for large lesion of the anterior canal fossa and sella with bilateral extensions, like craniopharyngiomas, planum sphenoidal meningiomas, or even aneurysms, right? You see the head is extended. Surgical position, again, I will emphasize constantly, you will get tired of it, because for me, surgical position is extremely important, because as I mentioned before, I do my best to avoid the need for frontal lobe retraction, right? So whatever it takes, for me, surgical position, so taking chance of the gravity. Second is bone resection. Sometimes that's why I need to object. I'll be very fashionable if I tell you minimally invasive approaches, bone resection to a minimum, but I strongly advocate some good resection of the bone. Just because at the end, the good resection bone allows you to do a good, you take chance of the gravity. So basically, if you free that bone around the frontal lobe, for example, that allows the frontal lobe to fall back following the gravity as much as it can, particularly if you are capable or just a good arachnoid dissection and detaching dura from the base of the skull, that allows you, I'm talking about no enormous retraction, I want you to misunderstand. I'm talking even just 1 centimeter or a few millimeters would be incredible, successful target goal if you really want to try to avoid spatula. Together with a good positioning and a good angle of the microscope, all these three things together will allow you to just give a good unobstructed view to the lesion and allow you not to use bare retraction. That would be incredible if you achieve to do that. The approach could be different according to the extension of the lesion. You can go from a simple subfrontal, because it is a typical subfrontal without involving the supraorbital rim, or you can involve the supraorbital rim in your approach, or you can extend the approach on the other side. So basically, bilateral subfrontal. The three different degrees of surgical, I mean, bone resection, they are according to the extension of the tumor. Tumor unilateral, for example, spinal wing meningioma on this side, which is not going too much contralateral, I will use the unilateral subfrontal. And other, if you have a particular problem which you expect to have to retract the brain a little bit too much, in that case, I'll take the rim of the orbit. And that allowed me to change the angle of the microscope and to minimize the brain retraction. That's a good procedure, chance to avoid the complication that can arise from using too much spatula. If the lesion is extending bilaterally, so in this case, for example, a huge spinal wing meningioma or any kind of a tumor at the level of the lamina originating in the area or the planum sphenoidale lamina fibrosa, which extend mostly bilaterally, in that case, I have to do a bilateral extension of the subfrontal approach. And again, I don't go usually in technical. This is showing here is the burrow is done on top of the sinus. I usually don't do it. It's just my personal preference, but that is not. I don't want to be dogmatic about that. I try always make sure that I don't get some bleeding, troublesome bleeding from the surgical sinus. So always trying to manage this one on different on both sides. Right?
Hey everyone. everyone. Ryan Rad here from neurosurgerytraining.org. If you like that video, subscribe and donate to keep our content available for medical students across the world.